हमारा खेत था तो जाते थे दोस्तों के साथ खेलते थे और वहां पे सारा मजा आता था। फिर नदी आ गई तो काट लिया।
घाघरा नदी सारे काट लिया। गांव को कोई सूचना मिलती ही नहीं है। अगर कोई सूचना मिलती तो हम लोग को मदद मिलते, कोई मदद नहीं है हमारे लोगों को।
Aid agencies are struggling to get help to millions of people affected by devastating floods across South Asia. It's thought to be the worst.
Thousands of troops have already been put into action.
It was extremely frightening because we had no warning.
One of the most important variables during a crisis is reliable information. There's so much work that's already been done by governments, by the UN and NGOs, and we're trying to learn from that work, build on that, and assist them with their goals. In India, where we're running our first pilot program, the government has thousands of people who are measuring the water level in rivers across India with what is effectively very long measuring sticks, which are called stream gauges, every hour, which allows them to know whether the river will overflow and flood. But it doesn't yet allow them to understand exactly what areas are going to be affected, what neighborhoods or even what villages.
Any station calling? Any station?
वो हमें सभी सतर्क कर देते हैं कि बाढ़ आने वाली, आप लोग ऊंचे आ जाइए। नहीं नुकसान है उससे पहले पता चल जाएगा।
The response time is most crucial thing. Reducing the response time always plays very important and vital role in the whole disaster management framework. Advancement in technology would help us better in spreading this message faster.
Flood forecasting was a very exploratory project. The big technical question was, can we have enough information to try to do forecasting that would be accurate enough to make a difference? Starting with the basic needs for getting information about what's going on, where is it happening, what should they be doing?
To be able to provide a forecast in real time, we rely on the government we're working with. We complement their effort by adding accurate modeling to that process. We start by collecting thousands of satellite images to build a digital model of the terrain. Based on these maps, we generate hundreds of thousands of simulations of how the river could possibly behave. We receive the measurements from the government and cross those measurements with our simulations. We can then send those forecasts to individuals using search, maps, and Android notifications. This is an example of an alert that we can produce. This alert is for Patna. This alert is actually has over 90% accuracy. The lead time is incredibly important, yeah. Even more than the specifics.
Any information we can give, they will use.
You want to show them the alert? Talking to people who directly experience severe floods and understanding what they really need is incredibly important for us to know how we can really help.
This is an opportunity to collaborate in a global scale. We are in very exciting time to use technology to try to make a difference.
I can't imagine a greater privilege than to do what we love and do it in a way that could actually help people directly in a very profound way.
Our hope for the future is to give people a few more days of warning before a flood occurs and to use AI to scale this and provide these forecasts anywhere in the world, wherever people need them.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you again for joining us today. So for our next session, we will be covering and discussing text classification. But before we formally start, let me introduce to you our speaker for today. Thierno is the lead data scientist and passionate about natural language processing and everything that revolves around machine learning. He has been mentoring data scientist students and apprentices for 2 years. Before getting into data science, he did freelance work in web and mobile application development. And he is co-founder of Galsen AI, an artificial intelligence community in Senegal. He is also a Google developer expert in machine learning, a machine learning Coursera instructor, a ZINDI ambassador in Senegal, and co-organizer of GDG Dakar. So let's welcome our speaker for today, who will be covering text classification using TensorFlow, Thierno Diop.
Thank you, Ralph. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for having me. I'm really glad to be able to share some technique about text classification with all of you, and hope the presentation and the discussion will be interesting for you and for me also. Okay, so let me just share my screen. Can you see my screen, Ralph? Is it okay for everyone? Hello, Ralph. Is it okay?
Yes, you can see your screen. Yes, here now we can see your screen.
Yep. Okay, perfect. Okay, so the goal of this presentation is to show how text classification works and how we can use TensorFlow to do text classification from scratch and also doing text classification with transfer learning. So without further ado, let's start. So we're gonna talk about briefly machine learning and classification just to build the ground to talk next about text classification and also giving the difference between learning from scratch and using transfer learning. And after that, we're gonna do the code. So we're gonna use TensorFlow and Google Colab to do the training and coding the models. And after, we will just wrap up the presentation with some takeaway to help. Okay, so when we talk about machine learning, we have a different paradigm compared to traditional programming. When you do traditional programming, you know, you have your data, and as a developer, you have to write some rules, some functions, and to have your outputs. So that's how people do in the web development, mobile application, and any other software engineering program. And when you talk about machine learning, it's kind of different, because here you have the data, but then you have the result you want. So you take the data and the result, and then you give that to an algorithm who will try to find the program for you. So you don't have to write the program that will map your input to your output. So machine learning is just mostly about that, you know, having your data and your result and having something that can give a program that can map your data to your result, so your input to your output. So to do this, this part of computation here, you need something to do it. So you that's where libraries like TensorFlow come handy, you know, because you can, they can make it very easy for you to develop machine learning that can generate the program that we talked about. So here we're gonna use TensorFlow, which is an open source library for doing machine learning and deep learning. So TensorFlow can be used to do classical machine learning, so models like random forest and gradient boosting and those stuff. But also And mostly TensorFlow is used for deep learning stuff, and that's what we're gonna do here in this presentation. TensorFlow is also very flexible. You know, it's very easy to modify TensorFlow by creating new layers, new models, new loss functions. TensorFlow also has a very simplified API, mostly things like TensorFlow 2, which use Keras as a high-level API. And TensorFlow also can be used in many languages. So it's not only Python, though we're going to use Python, but you can use TensorFlow with Java, with Go, you know, and with JavaScript, so for web developers. So, you know, and there is a very large community around TensorFlow. So if you have questions, it's very easy most of the time to have your response in Stack Overflow or in GitHub or in other groups. So we're going to do classification. We're going to do text classification. So I think it's interesting to know, first of all, what is classification? So in machine learning, in supervised machine learning, you mostly have classification and regression. So here we're going to do classification, which means we're going to predict a categorical variable. So when we talk about classification, we have mostly three types. So we have binary classification, where you only want to predict whether something is this or that. So there is no other choice. You only have two choices. For example, here, let's say you want to classify a picture and you want to know whether the picture contains a cat or a dog. So that's all. That's binary classification. You can have multi-class classification. So here you have more than two possibilities for given objects. For example, here, we don't have only cat and dog. We may have lion and sheep. So here you can have more than two classes. So that's what you call multi-class. Multi-label is kind of something like multi-class, but it's different because the object or the observation can be linked to more than one class. So let's take our last examples where you have cat, dog, lion. Here an image may contain cat and dog. So that's why we call it multi-label, because you can have many labels for one observation. So in this case, for our test classification, we're going to do binary classification. So we just want to know if a comment about a movie is positive or negative. So here we're going to talk about how test classification works, because it's somewhat different compared to classic classification. For example, if you have a tabular data and you want to just predict some binary variable, because here you have more processing to do before giving the text, because text machine learning models can deal with text. So you have to transform your text and have it in a numerical format that your model can then take and learn from it. So text classification is very present in machine learning and in deep learning, because one can use text classification to classify articles in a website or news website. Text classification is also used in more big in bigger systems like Siri or Google Voice, for example, to detect what is the intention of the user, or to detect some entities in the sentence or in an utterance given by the user. So those are done by text classification, even though you have after that other part of the system who will use the result to give a response to the user, but you use text classification inside those bigger systems. So in practice, to do text classification using machine learning, you have at least some step of pre-processing to do. For example, let's say you have a text, the movie was excellent. You need to normalize the text, depending, of course, on the model you're going to use. But most of the time, you need to normalize the text, do the tokenization. So for example, here, the tokenization here, we are using just word tokenization. So you have the movie is excellent. So every word is put it in a list so that it's separated. Also, as you can see, we had the movie was, and here we have is. So this is part of a normalization step to limitize the words. So these are some steps people use to normalize the sentence so that every word is, you know, when you have many derivatives of the word, you just have the initial word. So for some application, this is not what people do because you don't want to do that. But for text classification, most of the time, this works better because you have less words in your vocabulary. And then you can give for every word a number that will represent the word, and so that you have numerical representation of your words. And then you can do some embedding or you can do back of word stuff and then give that to your model. So your model here is the classification model, and the model can tell you whether the command is positive or negative. And here, if the model is well trained, it will say the command is positive. So about encoding the sentence, about encoding the text, you have many ways of doing this. You have, for example, one-hot encoding. So for example, all you do is when you have your corpus, so you create your vocabulary. So your vocabulary is just the words you can have in your data set, or at least the words you want to care about. And then if the word is present in your sentence, you put one in that column. And if the word is not present in your sentence, you put zero in that column. For example, if you have the verb, the sentence, the cat sat, for example, you can say, okay, the is present, I will put one in the column where the is, and so on and so on. So this is one-hot encoding. You can also do back of word. So here, you don't say, okay, you don't just say the word is present. You are counting how many times the word is present in a sentence. So that's why you can see something like two, because here, for example, if you take this sentence, it is puppy and it is extremely cute. You can see that it comes two times. That's why you have two here. But puppy comes only one time, so that's why you have one. So this is just the difference between back of word and one-hot encoding representation of words in a sentence. But you have something more interesting also, which is embeddings. So embeddings are mostly trained and with deep learning models or with neural networks models. For example, here the goal is to have an embedding that can represent semantically the word. Because what you have here, there is no semantic here. But what you have here in embedding, if you train a model to give you embedding of words, you can have good representation that are semantically meaningful. What that means is if you project your embeddings in a 2D space, for example, you can see that words that represent more or less the same stuff are near the other. For example, here you can see that pencil and pen are are in the same positions compared to other words like wombat or, you know, you can see, for example, writing, pen, pencil are in the same area because they represent the same meaning. So that's why embedding is interesting because you have the semantical meaning, and that also help your model to be able to do the text classification better because there is the sense of the word in the embeddings. And this helps us also to be able to capture synonyms. For example, if you have pen or pencils, the model will have the more or less the same representation of the word. So that helps the model to be able to do the same classification whether you have pen or pencil, which is not the case is in one-hot encoding or in back of word. So that's also a very interesting characteristic of having embedding that represents the semantic of the word or a sentence. So here we're going to talk about, before diving into the code, what are the difference between learning from scratch or and between learning from transfer learning. So when you learn from scratch, what that means is you have your data, and all you do is you train your model with just your data, and you train your model from scratch, which means in the beginning, your weight, so the weight of the model are randomly initialized. And then you just take the data, you train your model with that data, and you have your model, and that's done. When you talk about transfer learning, what you can have is you have, for example, other models that are trained in using large data, but not your data, but you know, more or less in the same context, in the same type of data. For example, text data. If you are doing text classification, maybe some model was trained in for doing text classification or for doing text inference, anything that that is related to text. Then what you do is you take that model and you have your data. So you take the weights that are used in that old model and you try to transfer those weights in your model, or you just try to give your input data to that model, and maybe that model will give you an embedding or just an output that you can use to train your model. So it depends. You can just take the model as an inference model and take the embeddings or output from that model and train a new model. So just to have a better representation of your data. You can also take the weight of that model and, you know, try to modify those weight with some part you will add, you know, some layers that you will add to that old model and do the training. So transfer learning is just about transferring knowledge that is from another model to your model. So it's just something like this. For example, here you can see that we have a network A, which has some inputs, and you know, this green box here, you can see it as being the bottleneck. So something that we're gonna use to, something that we can use as the final layer when we're gonna do our transfer learning, because we can say that, okay, these parts here are just specific to the task that was solved by the network A. So this is not interesting for us, because we have another task, another problem. So we just transfer this weight here to our new model, for example, and then we add our own stuff here that will be randomly initialized here. And then all we have to do is, you know, when we have the input, we go from these layers that are already trained with the network A, and we can just take the output and try to train these layers. We can also do the training of these layers, but you know, we will do it after, most of the time, after training these layers, and then try to optimize these to be more fit to our problem. So this is some kind of transfer learning people use. And in our case, we just gonna use a model that is already trained, and we will just give our sentences, and the model will give us embeddings of those sentences, and these embeddings represents the semantic of the sentence, and we're going to use this to do our classification problem. So this is how we're going to use transfer learning in our case. So just some advantage and some disadvantage of these two approaches. Like when you do from scratch, at least you know that you will not have any bias that come from other models, because that can happen. Some models may have some bias about gender or ethnicity, and maybe if you take a model, it's hard to not also inherit from those bias. So that's also something that is good about training from scratch. But the problem is, when you want to train from scratch, you need more data. Sometimes also, most of the time, you may overfit quickly if you don't have enough data. And the training also is very slow, because you are training your model from scratch. So you have to do many epochs to do the optimization, especially if you have big data set, and you need big data set anyway to do training from scratch, especially if you want to have if you have big models. When you do transfer learning, you can train a model with very less data, because you can have the weight that are already trained in with other models, and then you can just update very few layers that you can add for your own problem. So you need less data because you have less parameter to train, and your training will go faster because you also have less parameter to less parameters to train, so your training will go faster. But the problem also, as we said, so you can have bias from other models, and you know, most of the time the models you're going to use to do transfer learning are very big models, so that's also, that can cause problem, memory problems, and also you can have inferences that are slow. But you know, you can also do transfer learning without taking just the weight of those models. You can do transfer learning, more advanced technique. In more advanced technique in transfer learning, you can have your own model, very small model, and you just will try to do meta learning, you know, to say, okay, this is my small model. I want this small model to give the same outputs in some different layers that are similar to the outputs of my old model. And so you are not having a big model when you're doing transfer learning, but those kind of framework are, you know, are harder to code and to train because you have different losses and all those stuff. But that's also a possibility if you don't want to have the problem of bigger model and slow inference. Okay, so that was all the theory I think needed to know the difference between transfer learning and learning from scratch, and also text classification. So now we're gonna go to the coding part, which is the fun part, using Google Colab, which is a free tool that one can use to do machine learning directly in your web navigator, and also the instances that you will use here is free for you, and it is in the cloud, so it's not your laptop or your machine. So this can be handy if you don't have enough power in your laptop or in your machine. So that's what we're gonna do here. So we will just click on this link. So if you have any question, don't hesitate during the presentation or during the code, so you can follow maybe better. So here, we're gonna use this notebook. So this is just a notebook if you don't know. So you have code and you can execute the code and have your outputs. So here, let's just do the import. So we're gonna import some libraries like TensorFlow, of course, NumPy and Seaborn to do some visualization. So as you can see, it's allocating and connecting to a virtual instance, which is in the cloud. So this is not using the computation of my laptop. So we also have free GPU here. For example, if you go on the runtime and you choose change runtime type, it's GPU runtime. So that will help us to do faster training compared to using CPU. So now the import is done. So this is the different step we're gonna flow here. We're gonna load the data and explore some stuff about the data. We're gonna show how to use embedding layer that we talked about in the presentation in TensorFlow. We're gonna build a model from scratch, and then we're gonna build a model using transfer learning and compare these two models. So let's go on the data exploration and data loading part. So we're gonna use a data set called EMDB reviews, which is many comments from users about some movies. And they say, they just comment about the movie. So whether the comment is positive or negative. So our goal, as we said, is to predict, given a text, whether the text, the comment of the user is positive or negative about that film. So here we're gonna use TensorFlow data set. TensorFlow dataset has many datasets inside it, so it's a library, and we're going to use load to load the MDB review, and we're going to split the data in train and test set. And after that, you have train data and test data, that's as easy as that. And then we can have a NumPy version of our dataset using just as NumPy. So this is for us to be able to, after to separate the data and also do some visualization easier. So let's execute this. So if it's the first time, this has to go on the internet and download the data set, as you can see. But if the second time and afterward, it will not download the data set because you already have your data set in your laptop. So there will be no need to go and download the data set. So just before this finish, I just wanted to show you that you are also able to use your own data set. So which is most of the time what you want by using just this one, text data set from directory, which is very easy. And you just give your directory and your batch size and validation split, and you're good to go. So this is really very handy. If you have your data set, for example, in a folder and you have one file per command, so you can just use this to have the same data set. So for example, if you wanted to do classification with your own text data set, you just replace this with what we have here, and you will have these variables, train data set and val data set, and you can use them just as we are using the data set from EMDB data set. So this is really very handy to do data loading, to do your training. So okay, now the data set is loaded and ready to go. Let's explore the data set. So here we want to see, as you can see here, the size of the test and the training example. So you can just execute the cell here using shift enter, or you can just click on this play button. So we have 25,000 for the training and also for the test set. So this is not that big data set, but it's enough for our use case. So here we can see the 10 first examples in the training data set. So here you have just sentences as we were expecting. So for example, here you have, this was an absolutely terrible movie, don't be alerted, and so on and so on. So you have the text for any, for every of the data set, but you can see that sometimes you have HTML tags here, and after we're gonna see how to clean this. So, but yes, at the end, this is what you have here in the data set. And we can see also the labels. So here you have 0 and 1. So 0 to say this was negative, and 1 this is positive. So just to show you about the embedding layers. So in Keras, you have, in TensorFlow, so Keras is just now part of TensorFlow, you have layers, and then you have this embedding layer. So this embedding layer will help us do what we talked about earlier, which means having an embedding that can represent your word semantically. So here you give the size of the vocabulary, which is, let's say, 1,000. This means you can't have more than 1,000 different words. So if you have words that are not in your vocabulary, you just have to link those words to, for example, an unknown word and so on. So this will really depend on the size of your data set, how many words you want to take into account, and how many data set you have to be able to train a bigger embedding layer. And here's the 5 means our embedding will be of size 5. So the vector of that represent every word is a vector of 5 elements. So this also, the size of this also will depend on the size of your data set. So if you have a bigger data set, you can increase this size to have a better representations of your word. So let's just execute this to create a new embedding layer. So it's done. Now we call the embedding layer here. Oops, sorry. We call the embedding layer here, and we give a constant. So here we can give just a list of 1, 2, 3. And normally 1 here represent a word, because a word will be first represented by a numerical number. So here 1 is just the second word in our vocabulary. 2 is the third word, because we are counting from 0. And so what all we want to have is to represent every of these words using an embedding vector. So if we execute this, so for now, this embedding layer is not trained. So the weight of this embedding layer are random. But just to show you how embedding works. So here you can see that for the first, you have this vector, and so you have a matrix of 3 rows and 5 columns. So every row represents the embedding of a given word here. So this is just how it works. So during training, you can just take these and concatenate them or use a recurrent neural network to take one by one and so on. So after, we can also give a more complex thing. For example, here we can give this, for example, you can take this as being a sentence with 2-3 words, this also as being a sentence with 3 words. And then you can just do the same thing by adding the embedding layer. And here you can see when you do result 0, it is the embeddings of the first sentence. So for every word, we have the embedding. So this is how you would use this with training, by having many sentences and having batches of sentences. So you will have also batches of embedding to use in your next layer. So okay, so now we know how to use embedding layer, let's just build the model from scratch. So here we're gonna use this one. So this is just to show you the number of so the training data. Here we have two things, we have the labels and we have the sentences. So we're gonna create the training and the validation set here. So we don't want to use the test set for comparing our models. So here we're gonna just say, okay, xval is the first 10,000 sentences, and yval also will be the first 10,000 sentences, and partial x train and partial y train will have, of course, 15,000 sentences, because we have 25,000 sentences. So let's create this. Okay. Now let's talk about text processing. So as we saw in the beginning, the text we have, sometimes you have, for example, these tag here, this bear tag. So in TensorFlow, now you really have an easy way to do text vectorization, which means here it's just going from the text of the words to numerical representation, like 1, 2, 3, as we saw in the when we were talking about vocabulary and those stuff. So here we can say, okay, we have a function that will do the preprocessing of our data set. So it will first lowercase the sentence, then remove HTML. Here we just take beer here. And after, it will return the sentence. And here we have the vocab size, and we have the sequence length, which means how many words we can take into account in a given comment. If the word are not, if you don't have 100, we'll just part it. And if you have more than 100, we'll just take the first one, or the first 100 words, or the last 100 words. So this is a thing we can choose here. And after, we will create this vectorization layer by using the text vectorization class from TensorFlow. And we will give our function to pre-process the text. We will give also the vocab size, also the output mode. So it's int, which means every word will be just represented by a number, like 1, 2, 3. And we will also give the maximum sequence length that we can have. And then if you create this one, you just have to call adapt and give your training. So that you have your vectorization layer ready to go and let's say train it with our data set. So we're gonna just execute this. And we are ready to go. So now we can use this vectorization layer inside a TensorFlow model and give raw text as input. So this is very handy, because without this, you'll have to do all the pre-processing, all the representation in numerical. You will have to do the representation numerically before even giving this to your model. And when you deploy your model, you would have to also do that in your web application, and to be able to call the model. So this is really handy, having this directly inside your model. So we're gonna do the model building. So here we're gonna use the embedding size of our words will be 16 instead of 5 that we show last in the last series. So here we're gonna use sequential to build a model. Sequential help us to give the different layers. So here, our first layer, of course, will be the vectorization layer. And after we have the numeric representation, we will use the embedding layer to have our embeddings for each word. And then we will use global average pooling 1D. So this is just meaning, you know, you have many words in a sentence. So we're going to use global average pooling and apply it to the different word so that we only have, after this, one vector, because we are using the global average pooling. And then you have the TF layer here. This is dense, a dense layer with 16 neurons with the ReLU activation. And then you have a dense, the final dense, which is one, because we have only a binary problem. So that's why we have one neuron here. And we have the activation, which is sigmoid, which will convert the output from just 0 to 1. So two probabilities of having the one class or not. So this is that as easy as this. So you just have to add different layers in your sequential and you're good to go. So let's create this model. Then we will compile the model by giving the optimizer that we will use. So we will use Adam. We will also give the loss function, which will be binary cross entropy, since we are doing binary classification here. And we're gonna monitor the accuracy metric. So let's compile the model. And then we're gonna do the training. So to do the training also, it's very easy. You just call the fit model, the fit method. You give your training, so partial extent and partial y-train. You give the number of epoch, the batch size, which is here 512, and the validation data here also. And we want it to be verposed to have the different logs. So here's the training will start, and it will use the GPU. That's why it's that fast here. And as you can see, let's just see, okay. Okay, now it's done. And you can see here about the accuracy. This is the accuracy of the training. So we can go up to 78. And here you can go in the val accuracy, 76. So this is not that bad, considering we have just 5 epochs and also a very simple model here. But let's see, let's just save this. So the history, for example, here, as you can see, we have history again. So this will help us to be able to compare the result of this model to the learning for to the model that use transfer learning. So let's just save this in the scratch history dict. Okay, so now let's build a transfer learning model and see how it works. And how is it performing compared to the learning from scratch. So here we're going to use TensorFlow Hub, which is a library that helps us to use models that are already trained by someone else. So here we're going to use the universal sentence encoder, which will help us to represent a sentence with just one embedding. So the embedding will be 512 elements. So every sentence will be represented by a vector of 512 elements. So we're going to use the crash layer here. So help crash layer, so that this model is just used as being a layer in our model. So this is also very handy to be able to ingest a model to our a complete model to our own model. So this is very handy and is very easy to do with crash layer. So let's just do this. And here we will also see how the layer is behaving when we will give it our three first examples. So here also the TensorFlow need to load and download the model, which is the sentence encoder here in the cloud before we are able to use it to do some embeddings of our sentences. And as you can see here also, we are giving trainable egal false to tell to TensorFlow that we don't want to train these weights from the model when we will do our training. So that's why we are saying trainable equal false. It's taking too much time. Don't know what's happening here. Okay, perfect. It's done. So as you can see here, the hub layer, if you use it and give it the first three examples, you can see here we have the embeddings. So here, for every sentence, you have the embeddings. For example, here is the embedding of the first sentence, the embedding of the second sentence, the embedding of the last sentence. And every one of them is 512 elements. So this is very easy to use, as you can see. And we have an embedding that represents semantically our sentence. So we're going to use this to do our text classification. So for that, we're just going to create also, we're going to use sequential again, and we will add some layers. So we will first add the heap layer here, which is the universal sentence encoding model, which will produce the encoding of our sentence. After, we will add a dense layer, as we've done using the learning from scratch, and also add the last final layer, which will have also one run and the same activation. So this is the same thing as we saw in the learning from scratch. The thing that changed here is just we have simpler model by just adding one layer, which is the model universal sentence encoder. And there we had to add the text vectorization layer. We had to add the global average pooling conv 1D and all the stuff. So let's execute this. So this is the summary of the model. As you can see, we have our layer here, which is the model. And you can see there is many, many parameters here. And then we add our two final layer. But you can see that we have something like 200 million parameters. But the trainable parameters are just 8,000, because it's just these two. We are not training this one. So that's why. But if you see the model from scratch here, we had as trainable parameters, we have something like 160,000. So we had way more number of parameters. That's why you need also more data and more time to do the training, because you have more parameters to train and to modify and to optimize. So let's also do the compilation. So we're gonna use the same optimizer, the same loss function, so that we can compare fairly these two approaches. So now this is done. Let's train the model with the same code. So there is nothing changed here. It's the same training data, the same validation data, same number of epoch, and same number of batch size. So as you can see, this training may take here some time, because we have a big model, which is the universal sentence encoder. And even though we are not optimizing that model, we are doing the forward with that model. So the data in the input have to pass through all the layers of the universal sentence encoder model before going through the two final layers that we added. So that's why this takes some time. As you said, when you do transfer learning, you have bigger model, and bigger model will take more time for the forward pass, even though you are not optimizing those weight. If you were to optimize the weight, it will take way more time to do the training. But something which is interesting here, as you can see, is just during the first epoch here, you have something like 73 of accuracy. And during the second epoch here, we have 80 of accuracy. And in the first model, so the learning from scratch, our best score in the training was just something like 70 to something. And here, more interesting is you can see the validation accuracy here is 81 here. Just in the second epoch, you have 81% of accuracy. We didn't even go near this number in the learning from scratch. So this is why transfer learning is really very handy. Most of the time, you have better chance to have a better model using transfer learning. Sometimes it's not the case. Sometimes the model is trained on very, very different data compared to your data. But most of the time, this works really great. And now we are in the last epoch here. So after this, we're going to compare the performance of training using transfer learning and training using just a model from scratch. So as you can see here, in the final epoch, we have in the training, we have 84% of accuracy. And in the validation here, you have 84 also of accuracy. One thing to note here is it's really handy because we don't really have, we are not really overfitting the data. So this is also a very good thing. So let's just see in comparison. Before that, let's see the different metrics that we have here. So we have the loss and the accuracy. So we're gonna do the evaluation using the test set here, not the validation set. So this is using the 25,000 examples in the test set to compare the models. So as you can see, as I said, the prediction using our transfer learning approach is taking more time because we have more weights and more parameters, so more computation. So that's why this takes more time. Even though we have a way better model, but this is something to take into account. It is whether you can have the time, you know, and the resources needed to use bigger model in your transfer learning setup. Because as I said, you can also use other way of transfer learning using, for example, meta learning to do that, which you can have a smaller model, but you know, you have to do more code, and you know, you have to, it's more complex to do. And here you can see that our model from scratch have in the test set have 75% of accuracy, and our model using transfer learning have 83% of accuracy, which is way better than this one here. So let's just do some comparison using some graphics here. So we just gonna create some variables here to get the hist from our transfer learning model, the history. And this is just some code to show the graphics. So you are just using matplotlib here to do this. And as you can see here, here we are talking about the accuracy. And you can see here that in the transfer learning model, we have the training accuracy in blue here and the validation accuracy in orange. And as you can see, there is no overfitting. And even from the beginning here, the first epoch, you can see that we are very high in terms of accuracy. So we are at 70% here. And then we are at 8% during all this. And there is no difference really between training and validation accuracy, which is a good news because we aren't overfitting. And if we take a look in the learning from scratch model here, we can see that we are learning. That's also good here, but we are really learning very slowly. We go from 50% of accuracy and we are going up. And until here in the fourth epoch, we are beginning to overfit because we can see that our validation accuracy is going down, but the training accuracy is increasing. So this is, as we said, it's very easy to do overfit when you're doing learning from scratch, especially when you don't have enough data set and you have many parameters to train, as we saw when we saw the model summary. So let's also take a look to the loss function. So as you can see also here in the transfer learning, this is the learning from scratch. As you can see, the loss decreased here, but you know, it's not really decreasing very well. But if you see the training loss with the transfer learning approach, you can see that the loss decreases. From the beginning, we have 0.5, and at the end, just with five epoch, we go to 0.4 loss. So this is also decreasing better than this one here. So just to say that transfer learning can really have very good impact on our training process, especially if we don't have enough data, and also if we can have a model that fits our need in terms of transfer learning. Because it's not like you have this all the time. For example, if you were doing test classification in Philippine language, this may not work because you may not be able to have a model that is trained on Philippine languages. So it can be harder to find a way to do transfer learning. So just to wrap it up, I just wanted to give you some takeaways. So I think it's good to use transfer learning whenever you have the chance, because it works most of the time better and it asks less resources in training and also having more accuracy. Also, text TensorFlow pre-processing layers are very cool to use because it makes the training and the deployment of your model really smooth, because you don't have to do all the coding and separate the pre-processing from the training and also in the deployment process. TensorFlow Hub also contains more models than the one we just show here. So it also have models in computer vision and other domains of machine learning. TensorFlow data sets also that we use to have the EMDB review have all the data set, text data set, but also image data set and all the data set about speech recognition, for example. Also, whenever you do a model in TensorFlow, try to use the high-level APIs if that fits your need. And most of the time, I would say 9% of the time, all you need is just the high-level APIs using Keras layers, and that really help to go very fast and also to be able to do prototyping very fast. So these are also some resources that you can use to have more understanding of these approaches. And after, I think I will just share the slides with you and also the collab notebooks for you to have better understanding of this and also to play with the collab notebook, modify it and see what the result will be. For example, you can train with more epochs and see if the result will, if the accuracy will increase or not, and also try to add other layers or maybe remove some layers to see what the result will be. So that was all for me. Thank you. And if you have any questions or suggestions, you're welcome.
Okay, thank you so much, Thierno, for that interesting talk about text classification. So before we like head straight to some of the questions asked, you were able to provide a clear separation as to if you're going to build from scratch or if you're going to use transfer learning. Based on your experience, which specific use cases would work on one of those approaches?
Okay, I think, as I said, if you have a use case where you already have where you can have models that are trained in data set that are not that different to yours, and you also have less data, and maybe also you have less resources, for example, you don't have enough GPU to train your model from scratch, I think it's always better to do transfer learning in those cases, because anyway, you don't really have the choice. But if you have enough data and enough compute, sometimes doing learning from scratch can yield to better results. But also, it will help you to not inherit from biases, some bias coming from other models. But I would say that most of the time, transfer learning really is a good choice in any domain you are doing. But just suppose you can do it, because as I said, for example, here we speak Wolofs. If I want to do speech recognition model, I can't just hope to use a speech recognition model trained in English and make it work in our language, because most of the time it won't work. Sometimes it works, but it will not work as if I were doing transfer learning using also some English data set that I am interested in. So that's also a thing to take into account, especially when doing text, because in speech it may work, but in text it just won't work because text is more complicated because you don't have the same word, you don't write the same thing, and you don't have the same vocabulary. But in speech, transfer learning, even if I use English in two of it works, you know, more or less.
Okay. You were telling about enough data. What is enough data if you're going to build models from scratch? Is there like a number, or it really depends? How do you usually work if we're going to build a model or a text classification model from scratch?
I think that's a trick question, but if we consider just text classification, I would say that text classification is also, it will depend whether you do binary classification, multi-class, or multi-level, because if it's binary classification, you don't really have that much data. I would say, for example, in this example where we have 25,000 observation is really a good start, a very good start to have a good model. But if you're doing, for example, multi-level classification, where you have many levels and one observation can be linked to many classes in the same time, you need to capture more diversity and, you know, more nuances in your data set. So that's why you will also need more observation to do your training. So this is really, should really depend on the complexity of your task. But if it's text classification, for some text classification, it's easy. For example, the text classification we were doing here is kind of easy because the words don't overlap that much, you know, the important words. But you can have text classification where the nuance is very little, and then you will need more data set to capture all those nuances to be able to do your training. So this is really, this will really depend on your problem, on your number of classes, you know.
Okay. We have another question from the crowd. So it's like a clarification. Is transfer learning only for neural network? If not, then what other algorithms support transfer learning?
That's a good question. I think, yes, I would say that most of the time we do transfer learning in neural network because we have weight, and we can have embeddings. We can also, it's easy to tweak machine neural network models. So, but you can also do transfer learning, for example, in linear regression, for example, because if you have weight in some linear regression problem, you would be able to do transfer learning, but this would mean that you have, for example, the same number of features, for example. And this would mean also that your features are somewhat similar to the model you trained with the linear regression problem before you do the transfer learning. So it's way harder to do transfer learning in those kind of model, and sometimes it's not just possible. For example, if you do random forest models and or those models, it's just almost not possible to do transfer learning. Also, at least if you do it very manually, so it will become just, you know, doing feature engineering stuff. But I can't call this transfer learning, because transfer learning is supposed just to be able to transfer very easily some knowledge from one model to another model.
Okay, thanks for that clarification, Thierno. Is transfer learning only relevant for text, or is it also relevant to other data sets out there? What other data sets where transfer learning can actually be used?
Okay, cool. I think transfer learning, as we know it now, especially in deep learning, is mainly from image data set, especially from imaginary data set. So no, transfer learning can be used in any domain, whether you have text, speech, image, and all those stuff. And for example, if you want to do image classification, you can easily use models like VGNet or ResNet that are trained in data set like ImageNet or Cypher10 and do your transfer learning with those models. So it's not really limited to text or image data set. It just It is just having one model that is trained on this same kind of data set you want to do your modeling, and just taking those weight or the output of those models as input to your model.
Okay. In terms of like data collection, especially for text classification problems, anything that you would want to give advice, especially for those who are first going to start with this type of like projects? You mentioned about doing specific projects related to understanding sentiments. Are there any other use cases where text classification is relevant in the outside world, like moving it into production?
Yes, I think text classification is mostly used in industry for automating text-related work. For example, doing spam detection. For example, as you already know, Google and all the mailing software are doing spam classification, and that was one of the main application of text classification. As I said, also, it's something you can use to do, for example, you can classify news articles and all those stuff. And I think to start, it's easier to just, you know, take some data sets that are open source like this one and play with these, train your own model, try to modify it, try to see different approach of doing text classification, because here we just used a very simple convolutional neural network here to do the global average pooling and do the classification. We also use transfer learning using universal sentence encoder, but you could use a more complete convolutional neural network to do text classification. You could use recurrent neural network to do text classification. You could use all the transfer learning models that are also available on TensorFlow Hub to do text classification. So I think just going through the different examples, because all these are examples from TensorFlow websites. So I think going through those tutorials and try to understand them, modify them, to see how that affect the accuracy of your model classification. I think those are really good way to start off doing test classification.
All right. Thank you so much, Thierno, for sharing your time with us. And spending your time early in the morning there in Senegal to share your expertise with us on natural language processing, especially in the area of like text classification. I hope you had a great time, and we appreciate all of those who are here with us to join our live stream. And we will be making this video available for that you can watch it later. And again, Thierno, thank you so much for your time, and we hope to see you again very soon.
Thank you. Thank you. It was a pleasure for me, and I hope that we're going to see each other soon.
All right. Thank you so much, Thierno. Bye-bye.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning on our TF Showcase workshop. This is our last workshop. We already have made the videos available, so you can watch them and rewatch them again on our Facebook page and also on our YouTube page. As mentioned, don't forget to go visit aipilipinas.org if you are planning to join our TensorFlow Showcase, Project Showcase. So again, as shared, the submission is on November 27th. You still have time to create your applications to join the said event. Thank you so much, and hope you have a great weekend, everyone.